As I touched upon in the last session, nearly 10 fault grounds of divorce are available under various personal laws, including the Special Marriage Act, which is of course secular. If I just mention a few, it is subsection 1 of section 13 with subclass 1 and subsection 1A of section 27 and section 32D and section 10 respectively of Hindu Marriage Act, Special Marriage Act, Indian Divorce Act and the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act. They provide way for dissolution or divorce on the grounds of adultery on the part of the spouse, the respondent. The ground of adultery as such is not openly available under the Muslim law, but Muslim law has recognized the practice of getting the marriage dissolved in case if a Muslim woman finds that the husband has got nexus with a woman of evil repute, or his act of leading an infamous or wayward life is a ground of divorce. It is permissible as a matter of cruelty under the Muslim law. So, as I said already in the last session, adultery and adult has got nothing to do with the only the five first letters are common, but adultery has arisen out of the word adulteration. So, as I said, section 13.1 of the Hindu Marriage Act 1955 and section 27.1A of the Special Marriage Act of 1954 and section 32D of the Divorce Act and section 10 of the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act speaks of the fault ground of adultery as one of the grounds of divorce. The question is, the wordings are not synonymous or same under different personal laws. Though the act of adultery is found to be one of the foremost grounds of dissolution of marriage, the wordings are differently employed in different personal laws. Under the Hindu Marriage Act and the Special Marriage Act that were contemporaneous to each other, the words used or the clause used is as follows: that the other party has, after the solemnization of the marriage, had voluntary sexual intercourse with any other person other than his or her spouse. Tamil vandu thiruvallur vandu romba alagana vaathichirupar piran manai vilayamai appdi. So under the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act, the language employed is slightly different. As I already told you, it is a suit, not a original petition like the Muslim law, and the language employed by the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act 1936 in section 10 is as follows: the defendant has, since the marriage, committed adultery. The straight word adultery is implied in Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act. There is a small distinction in the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act, where only a suit will lay and not original petition would be maintainable. And under the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act, a decree of divorce will not be granted on the ground of adultery if the suit is not laid within 2 years from the date of knowledge of the act of adultery. It amounts to condemnation under the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act. So on such a ground, no divorce can be granted under the Parsi Marriage. So when you go to the Indian Divorce Act, the clause is slightly different. It says the other party, since the solemnization of the marriage, the respondent has committed adultery. Here also they use the word straight adultery as in the case of the Parsi Marriage and Divorce Act. Now, under the Hindu Marriage Act, Special Marriage Act and also the Divorce Act 1869, adultery is also a ground for judicial separation in addition to being a ground for dissolution of marriage. So, when we go to the offense of adultery, we'll have to touch upon the latest development of law in the hands of the Supreme Court. Section 497 of the Indian Penal Code defines adultery and made it a penal offense, where if a man knowingly or after coming to know that a female is married and has voluntary sexual intercourse with her, it is accused of an offense of adultery. And in such case, in the absence of consent of the husband, of the wife, the person who has committed the act of adultery, namely the man, is accused of an commission of offense of adultery. Here the female is not an offender. She is not prosecuted. She is not how to be accused. But the law has undergone a sweeping changes in the year 2018, when the Supreme Court has declared it in Joseph Shine versus Union of India case, that adultery has been decriminalized, in the sense that adultery is no more a punishable offense under the Indian Penal Code, but adultery remains and continues to be a civil wrong, and it still continues to be one of the very valid grounds of divorce under the personal laws. So the result of the judgment of the Supreme Court is that adultery is no more a punishable offense under the IPC. It has lost the character of an offense, whereas it remains to be and continues to be a civil wrong, and it remains to be one of the forerunner of the ground of divorce on fault basis. And very strangely, I could find when I read the comparative provisions of law, in England, adultery is a mere civil wrong only, and the affected party or the aggrieved person has got a right to claim damages only. Even under the ancient or Shastri Hindu law, where divorce was not even contemplated, adultery was condemned in most unequivocal and heavy terms. In criminal action, as I said, the punishment is not against the wife, but it is against the adulterer. The wife is not guilty of the offense, and she is not even accused as an adulterer. But in the event of a matrimonial action for divorce on the ground of adultery, the main relief is sought for against the spouse only, and the relief is not against the so-called adulterer. But friends, please bear in your mind that whenever adultery is made as a ground of divorce under any of the personal laws, the adulterer, the so-called adulterer, should be named and he should be made as a co-respondent in the pleadings. There is one judgment to that effect in AAR 1997, Orissa, page 162, in a case between Madhu Smita Nayak versus Simadari Nayak. Madhu Smita Nayak versus Simadari Nayak, AAR 1997, Orissa, page 160, 162, where the court has gone to the extent of stating that in the event of the adulterer not named and made as a co-respondent, the original petition for divorce filed on the ground of adultery is not maintainable. Section 11 of the Indian Divorce Act is somewhat very unique. It says, adulterer and adulteress to be the correspondent, and it is made mandatory. But Section 11 of the Indian Divorce Act has given three incidents where an exemption can be sought for in not making the adulterer or adulteress as the correspondent. First circumstance is very unique and rare, and I have not come across any such case so far in my experience of 35 years and above. If the spouse, in case of female, is proven to be a prostitute, so the husband who alleges that the wife is accused of the offense or the civil wrong of adultery, the husband need not name the adulterer as co-respondent, because he may not be able to specify or ping into a particular name or a person. So in case of innumerable number of persons who are in contact with the wife being a prostitute, the act exempts the husband from naming anybody as the adulterer and the correspondent. Similarly, if the husband against whom the wife alleges adultery, he is a man of immoral character and has got the practice of leading a wayward life, keeping lot of women of such a repute as his concubine or captivitress and so on, so Section 11A exempts the wife from naming any individual as adulteress and correspondent in the petition. This is the first circumstances in which an exemption can be sought for. Second circumstance is the normal circumstances in which, though adultery has been pleaded as the ground of the divorce, but the husband or the wife, as the case may be, is not able to find out who the so-called adulterer is. He may be a person who is not in the sight of the petitioner, probably for the reason of secrecy maintained by the adulteress or adulterer and the wife, or the distance factor or the absence of the husband or wife in this part, he may not be in a position to know, or there is no authentic evidence to show that he is the man or he is the woman who can be named as an adulterer or adulteress in the original petition. So the second circumstances in which an exemption can be sought for is the inability to identify the adulterer under genuine circumstances. The third circumstances, everybody know that in case of the adulterer or the adulteress is dead before the institution of the original petition, she or he need not be named and made as a correspondent. But such a provision to implead the adulterer as a correspondent is something not found in any other act, and exemption is given only under the Indian Divorce Act. Anyhow, as a matter of in pari materia or external aid, we can borrow this section in other proceedings also. So when we go to the burden of proof or the nature of pleading required in case of divorce on the ground of adultery, the law expects a high degree of proof to grant such a relief on the ground of adultery. What is the essential ingredient of the ground of adultery is that the sexual intercourse was willingly indulged into. This is very important. The act of sexual intercourse by the respondent with any other person other than the petitioner must be a sexual intercourse, and it was willingly indulged into by the respondent. For example, if the wife is able to establish that there was a sexual intercourse which is involuntary and rather she was raped, in such case, the ground of adultery cannot be pressed into service. So it is not necessary to prove that the correspondent or adulterer or adulteress had knowledge that the respondent was wife or husband of so-and-so. It is not necessary to establish that the correspondent or the adulterer or the adulteress should know that the wife was married to a specified particular person. Absence of knowledge on the part of the respondent or correspondent or adulterer about the name of the petitioner is not a defense. So I just wanted to bring to your attention that persons who were covered by the Indian Christian Divorce Act, I think Indian Divorce Act, were very much unfortunate in the sense that Article 14 and 15 were very badly violated till 2001, because under the Divorce Act 1869, the ground of adultery was made to be an independent ground for divorce only for the husbands. Only husbands can maintain a petition for divorce under the Indian Divorce Act 1869 till the year 2001. And in case of women, such a ground was available, but not an independent ground of divorce. The wife under the Indian Divorce Act was not so entitled to take up the defense of, I think, take up the ground of adultery as the sole ground, unless the husband has committed adultery with other grounds like incestuous relationship or adultery coupled with cruelty or adultery coupled with bigamy or adultery coupled with desertion. So under the Christians, for the Christians under the Indian Divorce Act, the husband has got every right to take up the ground of adultery as an independent ground. But in case of women, wife under the Divorce Act, she has to take up other grounds of divorce also in addition to adultery, stating that adultery coupled with incestuous relationship or adultery coupled with bigamy, adultery coupled with cruelty, or adultery coupled with desertion. So the Christian woman under the Divorce Act 1869 were not allowed to take up the defense, take up the ground of adultery as the sole ground of divorce. They have to take other grounds together. So very many high courts were unhappy in the way in which adultery simpliciter was not made available to the Christian wives. Adultery simpliciter or adultery itself as a sole ground of divorce was available only to Christian men. It was the Kerala High Court for the first time that declared the provision unconstitutional in a case law between E.J. Amini versus Union of India, reported in AIR 1995 Kerala 252. AIR 1995 Kerala 252, in a case between E.J. Amini versus Union of India, where Section 10 of the Indian Divorce Act that provides for adultery simpliciter, a ground of decree of divorce only for the husband, not for the wife, has declared Section 10 as discriminatory and violative of Article 15. Subsequently, two other high courts followed suit. It was the Bombay High Court and the Andhra Pradesh High Court that have set aside the section as unconstitutional and violative of the provisions of Constitution. The Andhra Pradesh High Court in N. Sarada Mani versus G. Alexander, reported in AIR 1998, Andhra Pradesh 157. I repeat, N. Sarada Mani versus G. Alexander, in a case reported in AIR 1998, Andhra Pradesh 157. The AP High Court has declared Section 10 as unconstitutional. And again, it was the Bombay High Court in a case between Pragati Varghese versus Cyril George Varghese. Pragati Varghese versus Cyril George Varghese, in the case reported in AIR 1997 Bombay 349. These two case laws of the Bombay High Court and Andhra Pradesh High Court respectively have followed suit of the Kerala High Court and declared Section 10 of the Divorce Act unconstitutional. Ultimately, Union of India, the Parliament, thought fit of amending the Indian Divorce Act, and the anomaly was removed in the year 2001 by Act 51 of 2001, whereby the ground of adultery simpliciter or the ground of adultery individually, independently, is made available to Christian wives also. When I was just surfing the books and net for the definition of the word adultery, I don't find any apt or good definition of adultery. And in Indian IPC, Indian IM Penal Code, it is rather punitive in nature, where it has got more with the act of the sexual intercourse. So in civil law, I don't find any convincing definition of the term adultery. So in one case, I was surprised to find that it's an old case of 1954, Volume 2, All England Reports, page 373. In a case called Yes versus Yes, an English judge by name Korninsky has written as follows: Nobody has yet attempted to define adultery. And I do not propose to rush in where wiser men have not. So nobody has yet attempted to define adultery, and I don't propose to rush in where wiser men have not. That is the intricacy of the word definition of adultery. But anyhow, we have some ingredients of adultery. If it is made out, the ground is also deemed to be proved. So the sexual intercourse that is contemplated under the matrimonial ground of adultery should be with a non-spouse. I have a meaning in this sentence. The sexual intercourse contemplated under the matrimonial ground of adultery must be with a non-spouse. You may ask a question, how it can be with a spouse when bigamy is prevented? When bigamy is allowed, the sexual intercourse with the first wife or the second wife will not amount to adultery according to the established principles of law. Thus, sexual intercourse with a former or later wife of a polygamous marriage is not an incident of adultery. If the second marriage is void, there also sexual intercourse with the second wife will amount to adultery. It makes no difference between void and voidable marriages. Now let us plunge into an important new concept. We have to openly admit that the world has become so modern and wider, and extramarital affairs have become something common, and it is no more a very minor incident. These were the news that were in the last pages of the newspaper, but now it comes to the first and front line pages. Now let us just discuss about whether extramarital affair will amount to adultery or not. And most of the judgments say yes, because the question is only one thing. To make the offense made out for criminal law, it is different. But extramarital affair will amount to a ground of divorce under the various personal laws, because it amounts to a voluntary sexual intercourse with a person who is not the spouse of the petitioner. As I said, the actual sexual intercourse should have taken place, and mere attempt will not amount to adultery. Rape does not amount to adultery. And very importantly, if the wife lacks the mental capacity to give consent for sexual act of intercourse, such as age, minor, or mental soundness or something, the intercourse will not amount to voluntary one, and it is not a ground of divorce. So the person who alleges adultery on the part of the respondent should be in a position to prove, plead, and establish that the wife was conscious of the nature of sexual intercourse being made willfully. And in case when the wife or the respondent is able to prove that because of the age factor and mental incapacity, she was not in a position to give consent for such intercourse, it does not amount to adultery. A woman who has been administered a drink or a drug and is raped cannot be said to be committed an offense of adultery. But if the administration of drink or drug is voluntary, if the woman has taken the drug or drink voluntarily, knowing pretty well the consequences, when she is found with the respondent, co-respondent, and adulterer, it amounts to adultery. The law is so clear. And it all depends on the voluntary nature of administration of drug, that makes the act of sexual intercourse voluntary and consequently a ground of adultery or not. If I go to next important topic, the law is in the budding stage. To be frank with you, friends, you can find in every nook and corner of cities and villages, we have that infertility clinics. Infertility has become quite common, and the numbers are on the rise and increase. Impotency on the part of the men and infertility on the part of the woman, they have become a very hot topic, and it becomes a business also. And a wife who is not able to conceive within 7 or 6 years of marriage, irrespective of long patient waiting, they will be desperate to go for this kind of artificial insemination techniques. And I'm given to understand that the Union of India has passed 2 important bills in the parliament by both the houses. it's waiting the assent of the President of India. If it is given assent to, we are going to have a new law on the artificial insemination technique. AIT is on the way till the time. What about the defense of AID or AIH to be a defense in the eye of law whenever adultery is invoked by the petitioner? Before that, we have to go a little bit of scientific information about what is called AIH and AID. Friends, in the modern technology, whenever the woman is not able to conceive on account of either infertility of herself or the impotency of the husband, instead of going for a petition for divorce, it is safer to go for an artificial insemination technique and beget a child of her own. There are two kinds of artificial insemination technique. One is called AIH and the second is called AID. AIH is artificial insemination homologous, and AID is called artificial insemination donor. So the sperm of the husband can be inserted in the uterus of the wife without any actual physical intercourse, sexual intercourse. It is called AIH. In AIH, when the husband's sperm is inserted into the wife's uterus, it is called AIH. So the sperm used is that of the husband of the wife. It is not of anybody else. It is not a case of a donation as it happened in a movie called Vicky Donor in Hindi. So in AIH, the husband's sperm is inserted into the wife's uterus, and that is called AIH. But in case when the husband's sperm is not in a position to make the wife to conceive or fertilize, another man's sperm is donated and another man's sperm is inserted, it is called AID. This is the basic distinction between AIH and AID. Why I say this? In future, many of the matrimonial cases might take shape of this technology being used either as a sword or as a shield. What we call as a test tube baby, the development of the test tube baby falls in the first category, that is called AIH. The difference lies in the following. In the AIH, the fertilization of the embryo takes place inside the uterus of the wife, because the sperm is directly inserted into the uterus of the wife. So, but the fertilization or conception takes place inside the uterus of the wife. While in the later case, AID, the fertilization takes place in a dish outside the uterus. Then later, the embryo or the fertilized embryo is inserted into the uterus of the wife. It is called AID. Sometimes, why I say it has become relevant is, you might come across such incidents in the near future. The day is not far away. There are case laws in America, Canada, and Europe, and UK, and India is yet to achieve this milestone. Sometimes, a woman who commits adultery on account of impotency of the husband and becomes pregnant may pretend that she took recourse to AID. Here, that is why I say the bill passed by the government of India assumes importance, where the consent and the agreement is very much important. Indian courts are not going to recognize AID or AIH unless the husband and the wife give consent and it has been recorded and the donor is not in a position to identify the donor. These are all the proposed bill that has been passed by the parliament. There is one case in the year 1921. I don't know how it was possible in 1921 to achieve this kind of artificial insemination, where this question of wife taking the defense of AID in reply to the husband's petition for divorce on the issue of adultery was discussed. In a case law, it's very difficult to find it out. 1921, volume 49, OLR, page 15. It's a case from Canada where this was discussed by the courts. Thus, the question is AID, AIH, would they amount to consummation? I come to the legal aspect once again, because we all know that the non-consummation of marriage is a valid ground of divorce under some of the personal laws. both under the Muslim laws, the Special Marriage Act, willful non-consummation of marriage is a ground for annulment of the marriage. It is not a ground of divorce. It is a ground for declaration of nullity. Under the Parsi law, it's a ground for divorce, non-consummation of marriage willfully. So the basic purpose of marriage is not merely procreation. If it is mere procreation, AAD and AAH man be pressed into service as a defense. But the basic purpose of the institution of marriage is not merely procreation. It also for men, it is also meant for sexual intercourse. And hence, AIH and AID cannot be a valid substitute in any sense for sexual intercourse. So one cannot say that AID and AIH would amount to non-consummation. That is not the ground as of now to have it now. Neither AID nor AIH can amount to consummation of marriage. That is the law as of now. Let us patiently wait for the parliament to pass the law. Then we will decide the fate of these particular aspects. Then what about the burden of proof? I have one case law of the Madras High Court. Rita versus E. Prem Kumar. Rita versus E. Prem Kumar reported in 2018, Volume 3, Law Weekly, page 104, Division Bench of Madras High Court. Rita versus E. Prem Kumar, 2018, Volume 3, Law Weekly, page 104, Madras Division Bench. The burden of proof the burden of proof is always on the person who alleges adultery. We all know very well that the Evidence Act is very clear that it is he who asserts must prove. So the burden of proof is on the person who alleges that the respondent is accused of adultery. Now, there is an important change in the law, which we seldom notice, that took place in the year 1976. I told you there was an act in the year 1976, Matrimonial Laws Amendment Act, where in a single strike of pen, the central government has amended lot of personal laws, irrespective of religion, with relating to matrimonial laws. So before 1976, the emphasis was for the word living in adultery. So the courts in the country, in the breadth and width of the country, across the country, were of the opinion that the adulterous life must be continuous one. A single act of adultery cannot amount to a ground of divorce. That was the law in force before 1976. Because of the word living in adultery, they took it up literally by following a present continuous tense, if I use the English language and grammar. But come 1976, the law was changed. Now, adultery need not be a continuous affair, or incidents of adultery is not required to make it a ground of divorce. A single act of adultery is now sufficient to get the degree of divorce. So if you want any more input, please go through the Amending Act of 1976, Matrimonial Amendment Act of 1976, that may give you a comparative study of the amendment made by the Parliament in the year 1976 in various personal laws governing the matrimonial disputes. So after the Amending Act of 1976, a petition for divorce can lie at the instant of the husband or the wife if the other party committed even a single act of adultery. It is not necessary to show that the respondent is living in adultery. This liberalized provision can be availed of even in a pending matrimonial dispute. That is what I call as a transitory provision. So whatever case law pending in 1976, they can be interpreted in such a way that living in adultery is dispensed with, and one single incident of adultery is sufficient when the act was amended in 1976. There was a case in the Madras High Court, AR 1969 Madras, page 235. AR 1969 Madras, page 235. Veera Reddy versus Krishnamma. And there is one more case in Madras High Court, AR 1967 Madras, 254. AR 1967 Madras 254, Puttai Ammal versus Manikam. In these two cases, the Madras High Court has given the burden of proof or onus of proof to be exercised and discharged in case adultery is taken as a ground of divorce. Then what is the nature of evidence called upon? Surrounding circumstances can do, and we don't require a direct evidence to prove adultery. That is given by the Madras High Court in AR 1965 Madras, page 29. AR 1965 Madras, page 29. Varadarajulu versus Baby Ammal. Varadarajulu versus Baby Ammal. AR 1965 Madras, page 29. It is held that surrounding circumstances can do and not direct evidence of. So, mere suspicion is not enough. AR 2003 Karnataka, page 25. Arun Kumar versus Nalin, where the court has held that suspicion is not enough in case of the ground of adultery. Then the next important corollary is access and non-access. Access and non-access cannot be the only source of defense, is some schools of thought. So access and non-access connote existence or non-existence of opportunities for marital intercourse. There is a judgment of the Supreme Court in the year 1954. Year 1954, Supreme Court 176. In a case between Venkateshwarlu versus Venkatanarayana, where the Supreme Court has gone into the minutest detail of the access and non-access theory to have the defense of adultery. And in the year 2003, the Supreme Court has given a judgment in a case called Sharda versus Dharampal. AR 2003, Supreme Court, page 3450. It's the first case of Supreme Court where the Supreme Court has permitted a blood test or a scientific evidence whenever infidelity or adultery is taken as a defense in a matrimonial proceedings. And we have to take the law into further by going to our DNA test. We have got case laws in the year 2014. Deepan Vita Roy's case, and there are some cases in which the Supreme Court has approved the use of DNA tests to decide the question of adultery and infidelity as a matter of ground of divorce in a matrimonial dispute. General observation of the Supreme Court in case of adultery, there is a judgment of the Supreme Court in the year 88, AR 1988 Supreme Court, page 2089, in a case between Vallabhadas versus Sushila Bai, AR 1988 Supreme Court 2089, Vallabhadas versus Sushila Bai, where the Supreme Court has discussed the burden of proof and nature of evidence to be adduced in case of divorce on the ground of adultery. There is always presumptive innocence, or I would say that there is always a presumption of innocence, and it is for the petitioner to prove the allegations of adultery strictly and not by mere allegations without translating into reality. So section 23.1b of the Hindu Marriage Act is the one which I want to buttress into the last list of this session. Contravention. Can adultery be condoned by the petitioner? Here I just want to draw inference or a comparison to the criminal law of adultery. A person is said to have committed adultery as an offense if she has voluntary sexual intercourse with another woman, knowing pretty well that she was married, and in such a case, he is accused of adultery. Here, an important element is that the husband should not have given consent. Section 497 was deleted from the statute because of this absurd clause stating that an husband can give consent for wife committing adultery. So that consent part of the story is very much relevant into the criminal law. Again, such a provision is found in section 23.1b of the Hindu Marriage Act. It states that condemnation of adultery is an absolute bar to granting of any relief by way of judicial separation or divorce. Friends, I told you already, in case of Parsis where adultery is pleaded, unless the suit is filed within 2 years from the date of knowledge of the so-called adultery, no suit can be filed. So if 2 years have lapsed, the law presumes that the husband has condoned it. So cruelty or desertion or adultery, if it is condoned, they can no more be the ground of adultery. Such is the case also in case of adultery. Section 23.1b is very clear that condemnation of the act of adultery or the respondent by the petitioner, whether it is a male or female, amounts to a defense, the court is not bound to grant a degree of divorce. Section 23 of the Hindu Marriage Act speaks of the coordination theory of any ground of divorce, and adultery is one such ground that can be condoned by the party. So the change of law in 1976 is important, that single incident of adultery is enough. And in case of condonation, the law is very clear that when adultery is condoned, it is no more a ground of decree of divorce. If the wife is able to prove that the husband, or the husband is able to prove that the wife, they have condoned the act of adultery on their part, and if it is proved that it has been condoned, the court has got no right to grant a degree of divorce. And with this, I want to conclude today's session on adultery. Next session, probably, I may take two important grounds of divorce, desertion and cruelty. Till then, goodbye to everyone.